Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skewed the Script. We're going to look at the hiring discrimination study one more time, but this time we're going to analyze it in terms of a two-sample hypothesis test for proportions. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on the hypothesis test for the difference between two proportions. This is lesson 7.8 in our course sequence. In the United States, we've seen a persistent racial wage gap. Specifically, there's a significant difference in the median earnings between white people and black people. Some people explain this through social factors. They say there's inequities in schools, there's differences in the social networks that people have access to in industries where hiring might be preferenced, and there might be differences in the choice of career. But some people say there's still direct discrimination in the labor market. There is direct discrimination in who people choose to hire based on race. These are all considered confounding factors. It's hard to parse out what might be the cause. Is it one of these? Is it multiple of these? Is it none of these at all? So researchers wanted to test specifically, is there still hiring discrimination in the marketplace, direct discrimination in the job hiring process? And these two brilliant economists ran an amazing experiment that had a brilliant design to test this. And here's what they did. And note that this lesson is going to present a slightly simplified version of their experimental design. If you want to see the full version, you can go to it via the citation link here. What they did was they made identical resumes and they sent it out to employers. The only thing they changed on these resumes was the name. They used names commonly associated with white people and names commonly associated with black people. They saw, was there a difference in the rates of callbacks they got, even though their resumes were otherwise identical? They sent the resumes based on job ads in Boston, Chicago. So people posted in newspapers, hey, we're hiring, and they sent the resumes to them. There's a wide swath of jobs in various industries in a wide variety of position levels. And they contacted 4,890 employers with resumes. And to half, they assigned resumes with commonly white names, half assigned resumes with commonly black names. And they measured which group got proportionally more callbacks from employers. So today's key analysis will be, does a statistically significant difference in callbacks indicate if there are broader discriminatory practices happening? If you want to follow along using our guided notes, you can print it up at this URL here. So let's talk about how we conduct a hypothesis test in this case. We'll go through a more informal version of this hypothesis test now so we can understand conceptually, and then later when we go through the four-step process, you'll be able to see how you write it out more formally if it was a free response question on the AP exam. Here were the results from the study, and we say treatment one, group one, was the commonly white names on the resumes. Treatment two was the commonly black names on the resumes, and they had a sample size of 2,445 employers in both. They found that the callback rates was higher for the commonly white resumes. Specifically, that difference was about 3.4%. So if there's hiring discrimination, you would expect the proportion of callbacks to be higher for the white name group. And we saw that in the data. But the question we want to ask statistically is, are these proportions different enough to show discrimination? Or could this difference have been the result of chance alone, the random assignment process? So for example, say that by chance alone, the white name resumes got sent to employers that have a higher hiring rate by chance. Can we rule that out statistically? So recall when we're setting up these hypotheses, the court analogy we use when we talked about hypothesis tests for the first time, innocent until proven guilty. The null hypothesis is that innocent assumption. It's the default dull belief that you immediately have starting the experiment. Employers don't discriminate. Innocent until potentially we prove guilty in the alternative. Employees favor white applicants. This is the unproven research hypothesis that our data has to have evidence to show. So we can frame these hypotheses numerically like this. The null hypothesis is that there's no discrimination, so therefore the callback rates, the proportion of resumes that got a callback, is the same in both groups. They are equal. In the alternative, where there is discrimination, the white group would receive a higher rate of callbacks. Now, to make this a little bit more mathematically convenient for us, we can just do some simple algebra to simplify these hypotheses a little bit. Subtract P2 from both sides. In the null hypothesis, P1 minus P2 is equal to zero, meaning that you're assuming the proportions are equal. So when you subtract, then you get zero. The alternative, if you subtract P2 from both sides, is P1 minus P2 is greater than zero. The proportion of callbacks among the white group is higher, so therefore when you subtract, you get a positive number. This is a more mathematically convenient way to set up these hypotheses. So now let's go through the logic of a hypothesis test. Recall, this is what we do. We start by assuming the null, the default, is true. So I'm going to assume there's no discrimination in hiring. I'm going to start by making that assumption. And then I'm going to ask, if the null is actually is true, if my assumption is true, how likely is the data we've gathered? So if we saw that the resumes white names are getting a lot more callbacks than the ones with commonly used black names, then we might start to doubt that assumption. And so we draw a conclusion. Under my assumption of no discrimination, our observed data is unlikely. So therefore, I reject my earlier assumption. I'm convinced there actually is discrimination in this hiring process. So let's go through that. Let's assume the null is true. So we assume that there's no difference in callback rates among the group because there's no discrimination. So P1 minus P2 is zero. So now let's start thinking about how unusual the data we got was from the study under that assumption. So the study sent resumes to 4,890 businesses. And at that sample size, we can see what estimates we would likely get for these proportions subtracted if there's no discrimination, if we do a bunch of random assignments randomly. So let's find the randomization distribution of all possible random assignments and get the all possible difference between those sample proportions we could have gotten. That is a sampling or randomization distribution here. And under certain conditions, we know that this will be approximately normal, centered at zero, because we're proposing in this world that there's no discrimination under the null hypothesis assumption. So there's no difference, so we're centered at zero, with a little bit of variation defined by this formula for the standard deviation. Now this is really a standard error based on estimates, and note that we're using combined proportion, which we'll talk about in a second. So we're centered at zero, and we're assuming that P1 equals P2, so we're gonna use the combined proportion of callbacks from the groups to estimate what that proportion would be. So let's go through the calculations just to see how that looks. So the proportion of the commonly white name group that got a callback was 10.1%. The proportion of the commonly black name group that got a callback was 6.7%. So combined, if you add up all the people who got callbacks regardless of race among all the resumes that got sent out regardless of race, you find that proportion is 0.084. So that's the combined proportion we're going to use in our sampling distribution. And we put in the sample size we got as well, and we get this normal curve with a standard error of 0.0079. So now let's look at the data we actually got from our experiments. This is the distribution of sample proportions we get under the null assumption. Now let's look at the data we actually saw from our experiment. The actual difference was 0.034. That's way over here. And so you can see, it's pretty unusual. Like if our null assumption is true, and this is the distribution of sample proportions we likely get, this difference is high. It's very high compared to what we expect. So how unlikely was our data? Well, one way to measure that is how many standard errors is away from the null. This is what we call the z-test system. We did with one sample proportion, two. Now recall that with the 68, 95, 99.7 rule, if you're more than two standard deviations out, you're only leaving about 5% of the tails. It's pretty unlikely to be more than two standard deviations out from the center. So let's see if this is more than two standard deviations out from that null hypothesis. We're gonna do some calculator stuff that I'll show you in a bit. And we get the z-test statistic, the number of standard errors away from the null hypothesis we are, is 4.23. So if two standard errors away is unlikely, then 4.23 is very unlikely. Now, how unlikely exactly is it? We can get this probability of getting what we did, or more extreme, by getting the p-value, the probability there, the probability of getting that big of a difference or more under this null hypothesis assumption. So we do some calculator stuff that I'll show you in a second. We get it. That p-value is 0.00001. Very small p-value, very small probability of getting that. So is there convincing statistical evidence that commonly white names get a higher callback rate? Well, we have our hypotheses. We have the sample data we got. We assumed the null was true, and we measured how unlikely was the sampled difference that we got if that null was true. That unlikelihood was 0.0001. So very unlikely. So our sample data was very unlikely if we assume the null is true, so we're gonna start to doubt the null is true. Let's draw a conclusion. Under my assumption that there's no difference in callback rates, the actual observed data is very unlikely. So I'm gonna reject that earlier assumption given the data that I found. And the data shows me that there is convincing evidence that commonly white name resumes received a higher callback rate, or will receive a higher callback rate among similar jobs if you did this for everyone. So let's connect this to the idea of confidence intervals. In our last video, we made the confidence interval for the situation, which spanned this range, 0.0185 to 0.0495. Since the null hypothesis value, when you subtract and get zeros, outside our interval, it's not plausible to assume that null hypothesis value. Therefore, we reject the null hypothesis consistent with our test. There's evidence of a preference for white name resumes. And this usually happens, especially for two-sided tests. Not all the time, but usually if the null is outside the interval, in this case, if the value of zero is outside the interval, you would reject it. If the null is inside the interval, that means it's a plausible value and you can't necessarily reject it given the evidence you've got. But in this case, the only plausible values were all higher than zero, meaning all plausible values showed a preference towards a white name resume, so we rejected the null of no discrimination. So now let's go through the four-step process. This is how you would organize your work on a free response question if you had to do this on the AP exam. So do the results give convincing statistical evidence? That phrase means you know I have to do a hypothesis test. Let's go through the four-step process. First, I have to state my hypotheses, the significance level, and define my parameters. I do that here. Since the significance level wasn't stated in the problem, I'm going to assume 0.05. Name your inference method and check conditions. We're going to conduct a two-sample z-test. Remember, this is two samples, two treatment groups, for the difference between these proportions if all conditions are met. Why are we checking conditions? Well, as always, we assumed a sampling distribution, and that sampling distribution is only normal with this under certain conditions. And here's what the conditions apply to. Remember, the random condition means you're unbiased center. 10% means you have a calculable spread. And then the large counts assures you that you have an approximately normal sampling distribution. So random, employers were randomly assigned, because this was an experiment, not a sample, either a commonly white name resume or a commonly black name resume. So that was satisfied. 10%, oh sorry, next one thing to point out, if we're sampling rather than doing an experiment, we need to verify that the two samples were independent random samples. But because this is an experiment, we don't have to verify that. But if you're doing a sampling with two samples, you need to verify those samples are also independent, not just random. Now, 10% condition, we only need to check this 10% condition where the sample size is less than 1/10 of the population size if we're doing a sample. But in this case, we're doing an experiment with random assignment, so we do not need to check that condition. Lastly, the large counts condition. Note that for the large counts condition, I am putting in the combined sample proportion that we're hired because that's what we have in terms of our data. And we're not making the assumption under the null that there's a difference here. So we're gonna use that combined sample proportion there. What we do is we get these calculations and they're all greater than or equal to 10, so we're good to go. So note that large counts condition is slightly different than it is under the confidence interval where we use those different proportions. Now, let's go ahead and perform our calculations. If you want to pause on this screen, you can. I'm going to go through them right now. So to do this on the calculator, you go to Stat, go over to the Test menu, and then go all the way down to the two proportion Z test for hypothesis test. We're going to put in everything we know. We had 246 of the white name resumes get callbacks out of a total sample size of 2,445 among that group. We had 164 callbacks out of 2,445 as well for the black name resume group. And lastly, we need to put in our alternative hypothesis. In this case, our alternative hypothesis was that P1, the portion of callbacks in group one, was higher than group two, which was the commonly black name resume group. So we got that L in there, press calculate. And from here, you can pull out the Z test statistic, which is 4.23, as well as the P value. In this case, 1 times 10, to the negative fifth power, which is 0.00001. Make sure to report your z-test statistics, make sure to report your p-value, and it's nice to also report your calculator inputs. Lastly, we draw a conclusion. Here's our conclusion sample if you want a nice little succinct way to conclude your study. If I plug in what we know, because our p-value 0.00001 is less than our alpha value 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis. We have convincing evidence that commonly white name resumes get a higher callback rate for jobs similar to the ones in this study. That's what we can generalize to. So now let's go to our discussion question for today. We found that commonly white name resumes has statistically significant advantage in attracting callbacks. Does this result suggest discrimination at other levels of the hiring process, i.e., say for example, job offer rates after an interview, because this is a callbacks resume, not an interview, or does it also apply to starting salary estimates that are given to people who are just hired for a job, etc. Explain what you think. Thanks so much. Have a good one.